Hello and welcome to Medmont's M700 tutorial videos. In this tutorial, I'll discuss the various options for monitoring changes over time, such as disease progression. We'll look at data displays ranging from difference from baseline maps to the more advanced linear regression. We'll start from the difference from baseline map view. This tool allows you to compare a new exam to the baseline exams taken during your patient's first visits. First, select a patient and a map that you want to use. There are two ways to view a map as a difference from baseline. The most important is a difference from baseline view in the View tab. Press on View, and then select Difference from Baseline. If this is your first time looking at a difference from baseline map, you'll be prompted with a pop-up informing you that no baseline is defined. From here, you have two options. You can allow the software to automatically define a baseline, which will select from the first two suitable exams. Or, you can ask the software to let you choose your own baseline, which opens the new baseline window. This shows all the tests, with relevant information to aid you in choosing the best exams as baselines. You may want to define your own baselines if you know some of the early tests were unreliable, and choosing baseline tests with very little fixation loss can be important. Regardless of which option you choose, you can click the box at the bottom of this window to ensure the same option is selected for any new patients you need to define baselines for. If you do set this to occur automatically, the pop-up will no longer appear, but you may want to change it in the future. To do this, you have to go back to the Configure tab and open the Studio Preferences by pressing the Preferences button. In the Explorer pane, there's an M700 option where you'll find the baseline preferences. Please be aware that to use this feature, you'll need to have at least three thresholding exams for the patient in question. Okay, so you've defined a baseline. The difference from baseline view is now available to you. You'll see that in the exam window, there's an exam marked baseline. This is actually a separate map from the map you chose and exists purely to function as the baseline. The display options from the image view are still available to you in this view. What you'll see here is three maps. The top map on the left is your baseline exam. The exams it refers to are named by date in blue above the map. Below this map is the current exam you're evaluating. Again, the date of this exam is shown in blue. On the right is the difference from baseline map. There are a number of dates shown here. The last one is the date of the current exam. The others are previous exams that are also evaluated as part of the difference from baseline output. This becomes clearer when you understand the legend and how the points are evaluated. Each point is calculated individually and evaluated for defects. Points in the inner 6-degree rings that have a deviation of greater or equal to 8.1 decibels from the baseline, or 10.4 decibels for outside of 6 degrees, are defined as defects. Points outside the 22-degree ring are not analyzed. If a point is marked as having a defect, it's indicated on the map with an unfilled square. If it also had a defect in the previous exam, it's marked with a half-filled square. And if the previous two exams or more showed a defect at this spot, it's marked with a completely filled square. Finally, if the point was seen in the baseline, but not in the two most recent exams, an absolute defect is indicated with an X. These squares provide an indication of the confidence level that this point is truly deteriorating, as well as a measure of progression. The exams listed by date above the map may now make more sense. A filled box means that in both exams prior to this one, the stimulus point had a defect. Half-filled squares only had a defect in the previous exam, and the open boxes just showed up as defects in this exam. Below the maps are four charts. These display the pattern defect of all the exam history since the baseline exam, separated by quadrant. As pattern defect becomes more severe, the attribute increases. As you can see for this patient, during the 2 years of exam history since the baseline, the pattern defect has increased in both the superior nasal and temporal quadrants. In the difference from baseline map, we see a number of areas of maximum defect, as well as additional defects that have recently arisen in both superior quadrants. In the inferior quadrant, pattern defect has actually decreased. Looking at the bottom half of the difference map, we see that there has been almost no negative change, so this makes sense. The pattern defect is so small that it's below the limit for significant results, so the small decrease could be accounted for by higher quality test results due to patient learning or simply test variability. If you swap over to the Display tab, you'll notice that the display options are very similar to Image View. All the available options are designed to change only the baseline and current exam displays. Switching these settings around will not interfere with the difference from baseline map or the pattern defect charts. We have another option for viewing the difference from baseline map, which is to look at it as a standalone map type. If you return to the image view and then go back to the display options, you'll see that you can actually select difference from baseline from the map types drop-down menu. This is the same map you saw on the right of the difference from baseline view, but without the additional components. A second option for visualizing change in a specific map is to use the comparison view. Return to the view tab and choose compare from the active view section. This view is used to create a difference map between two selected maps. Choose the exam you're interested in, and select another to compare it to by holding down the control button when you click. This will produce a difference map of the two exams, with the older exam subtracted from the most recent. The map displayed in the right side is the result of this subtraction and shows areas of positive and negative change. As you saw in a previous video, you can grab the sectioning tool and move it through this map to analyze two-dimensional cross-sections. It's important to note that unlike the difference from baseline, the software has no requirements for which maps you select here. Be careful with which exams you compare, as you could accidentally compare a left and a right eye. Though the comparison view provides less specialized data than the difference from baseline view, it can be useful for visualizing and locating areas of change. As a final note on comparisons, in the display tab you'll again see similar display options to the other active view types. A unique feature in this view appears when selecting either of the numeric views. Stimulus locations that have had a significant change of greater than 6 decibels will be highlighted in red. The final tool for analyzing disease progression is the regression view. To access this, you must select the patient's name rather than a single exam. Select the patient you're interested in and press View and choose the regression view. The patient's regression view allows you to view the progression of any attribute recorded in an exam over time. In the first part of the toolbar, you see the settings panel. The drop-down menu in the top allows you to select which profile you want to view. There are three profiles defined by default to match our three supported products. We'll stick with the M700 regression profile for now, but you could also view the E300 or DV2000 results from here. The Edit button below allows you to make changes to the selected profile. You can change which eye data is displayed for, and set the date range of the exams that are included. Most importantly, you can change which graphs are displayed. You can edit a graph by selecting it and pressing Edit, or you can add new ones by pressing New. Both options will open the same window, allowing you to choose the attribute that is displayed, select what criteria the trend line follows, and either set a range for the data or have the graph automatically scale values to fit. From the settings bar, you can also choose which order the graphs are displayed in by selecting one and pressing the up or down arrows in the bottom right corner. The new button in the settings panel allows you to create your own custom profile. You must choose a name and then use the edit window to choose the graphs you want. You can also delete profiles by pressing the delete button. In the eye panel, you can select which eyes you want to display data for. If both eyes are selected, the right eye will be displayed in blue and the left in green. In the zone panel are options for breaking the data down by area of the exam. The full option uses all the data available, while central shows points out to 22. The macula zone is only within the central 10 degrees, and peripheral is between 23 and 50 degrees. All the quadrants display data from 9 degrees through to 23 degrees in the respective areas. Now that you know how to choose what data to display, let's take a look at the data. Each graph shows the data for a different attribute, which is displayed at the top of the graph. For data types that are expressed as a single number per exam, this data is shown as a single point. Overall defect and pattern defect are examples of this. One of the features unique to our perimetry results is the inclusion of histograms. These are displayed for any attribute that is not a single number and shows the distribution of test points in the exam. Histograms are rotated 90 degrees so that the test values can be displayed on the y-axis. Exam results are broken down into bins of 3 decibels, and the full range of data is shown by the vertical line at the base of the histogram. The strategy for distributing points through the histogram is a little more complex than just at a point-by-point basis, and you can read more about it in the M700 user manual. Not seen points are shown in red below the 0 decibel line at negative 3 decibels, which is not to say that they are recorded at negative 3 decibels. Finally, the black horizontal line that runs across the histogram is the mean value of all the points. The trend lines are shown in blue and green based on the eye and follow the mean values of the histograms or the single data points in other cases. The default method for creating trend lines uses the least squares method, which is a good fit for reasonably well-distributed data. When the data contains significant outliers, the least squares regression tends to be skewed from its true position. In this case, and for data that is highly variable, a median regression using M estimates provides a better fit. As I mentioned before, you can change the type of trend line in the setting window. If you click on any of the data points or histograms, you're presented with options in the selection section of the ribbon bar. You can press Show Exam to open the image view of that exam in a new window, which can be very helpful to investigate abnormal exam results. You can also delete an exam from the analysis by pressing the Remove button. However, unless you're confident that the exam is not important, perhaps it's a clear outlier based on a bad test, this may affect the power of the analysis. The final option available to you in the regression view is the Export button. This allows you to export all the data shown in the regression view to a CSV spreadsheet to use in your own external analysis. At that point, it's out of our hands. So for now, that's all. Goodbye, and I hope to catch you next time.